You're listening to the weekly sermon at Sacred Baptist Church in Cedartown, Georgia. Sacred Baptist Cedartown exists to worship God, disciple believers, and proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Hebrews chapter number 6. Hebrews chapter number 6. That's where we're going to be at this morning and continuing our study through the book of Hebrews. Thankful for McQuaid and for Briam the past couple of weeks and preaching through this book, and just a wonderful several passages of scripture that are that they preached on that are just heart stirring and I think help us to grow in our relationship with the Lord, especially in our understanding of who Jesus is and all Jesus has done for us, and just how Jesus is greater than anything in this world. And we're going to talk about this morning how His plans for us are greater. And God has better things ahead. There's one particular verse that I've just was struck by in Hebrews chapter 6. As the writer of Hebrews talks about the progression of the Christian life, that's really what we're talking about. And then the danger of not progressing and the importance of recognizing our Lord and as our Savior, Jesus, who leads us every day. And here's the reality when we talk about the Christian life. You're either growing or you're declining. There is no plateau in the Christian life. You may think, well, I've been a Christian for 30 or 40 years or whatever, and I've just kind of stayed the same. I've just kind of ridden this thing out for several years. Now, if you feel like you're in a plateau, you're actually in a decline spiritually. Because there are powers and principalities of darkness all around you. The devil himself is roaming to and fro, seeking whom he may devour. Do you think that he's going to let you stay in a status of plateau spiritually? He's going to go after those that are apathetic in their walk with the Lord. So you are either growing and progressing in your walk with Jesus, or you're declining. And we need to be aware of that this morning as we read in Hebrews chapter 6. And if you found your place, let's all stand just out of reverence of reading God's word this morning. Therefore, leaving the discussion of the elementary principles of Christ, let us go on to perfection or completion, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God, of the doctrine of baptisms, of laying on of hands, of resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment, and this we will do if God permits. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted the heavenly gift and have become partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come, if they fall away, to renew them again to repentance, since they crucify again for themselves the Son of God and put him to an open shame. For the earth which drinks in the rain that often comes upon it and bears herbs useful for those by whom it is cultivated receives blessing from God. But if it bears thorns and briars, it is rejected and near to being cursed, whose end is to be burned. But beloved, we are confident of better things concerning you. Yes, things that accompany salvation, though we speak in this manner. For God is not unjust to forget your work and labor of love, which you have shown toward his name, in that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. And we desire that each one of you show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope unto the end, that you do not become sluggish, but imitate those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. God, we pray for a blessing of the reading of your word. We thank you for this word. Lord, may you grow us in our relationship with you, and I pray that our heart's desire would be to serve you and worship you with our lives. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated this morning. Better things are ahead for those that believe in Jesus. That's the process of sanctification that we're talking about, and the foundation is laid in the first few chapters of the book of Hebrews, because the writer talks a great deal about how great Christ is, how he is greater than anything in this world, how he is more faithful, how he is the better example, how he is the greatest priest, the greatest prophet, the greatest king. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There's no one who compares to Jesus. And I'm thankful for that because it lays the foundation for the rest of what we talk about in the book of Hebrews. There is the imperative and the indicative here, literally telling us what we should know. And then we're getting into what we do with what we know. That is the nature of the Christian life. We should know and have a strong foundation in the Gospels and what His Word says. But then there should be application. There should be a process in which we take this truth and we apply it to our lives. As James says, faith without works is dead. It's useless. There's no sense to it. And so we can't just become theologians who don't implement what we believe. We need to study God's Word and apply it. And this is where we get into some of the application, I think, that the writer in the book of Hebrews is talking about, especially in the progression of the Christian life. So my main point is this: when we are followers of Jesus, we should desire better things than what the world has to offer. And we can even go beyond that, because these are things concerning salvation and our relationship with Jesus. We should desire the gospel, the message of Christ, the message of salvation, but then also recognizing this, that we go even further and we go even deeper into the Word of God, and we desire to grow, to know Christ and Him crucified, to know everything as we possibly can about Jesus, and to grow and to thrive in our personal relationship with Jesus. That's where our heart's desire ultimately should be. We should have this desire for better things, to move, to progress, to get closer and closer to the Lord, to grow in Christ's likeness every single day. And literally, we do this until the day we die. You realize that on this side of heaven, you never fully achieve the goal of the Christian life. There's always this element of hurry up and wait in the Christian life, where we are striving towards the goal that we have in heaven itself. But there's always this idea of that it's never going to be fully complete on this earth. We are surrounded by sinfulness, by fallenness, by our own sinfulness and by our own mistakes and everything else that happens in our lives. And so we're continuously trying to progress and move forward towards the kingdom of God. So when we're followers of Jesus, we should desire better things than what the world has to offer. I want to just focus on a few things in this particular passage in talking about the progression of the Christian life and how we should progress and the importance of this here in Hebrews chapter 6. And one is this: an important thing to remember is to not forget your foundation. Notice what the writer says about the foundation. The foundation really is those elementary principles, those basic doctrines of the faith. Those are important. He says that we're going to progress beyond those things. We're going to go further into the Word of God and talking about the application of those things. But we should not neglect those things. We should not forget the foundation, the basic doctrines of the faith. And when you look at the elements of this foundation, you can see that it's clearly addressed to a Jewish background, as it's been mentioned by McQuaid and Brehm, that those are who the author, the writer of the book of Hebrews, has in mind in particular. But when you look at the elements of this foundation, they are basic principles that are all familiar to every one of us. So let's look at a few of those. It says, leaving the discussion of the elementary principles, the basic doctrines of Christ, it says, let us go on to perfection, to completion, not laying again the foundation of what? Of repentance from dead works. There's one element of the foundation. Listen, these elements are really just the gospel message of Jesus. Repentance from dead works. Now, that was something that would have struck a chord with the audience that he has in mind, with a Jewish background. They had spent their lives, in many cases, pursuing dead works. There are the religious elite of their day who had added to, in many ways, the Word of God, all of these things that needed to be done concerning the Sabbath and everything else. And they had taken the laws of God and they had tried to apply them to their lives, but they had done so in a way where they created a system of dead works, where they were trying to earn favor with God through their works. And that's not necessarily the point of the law. The point of the law is to point out our sinfulness, the fact that we can never fully obtain salvation through our works. It's impossible. There's nothing you and I could ever do to completely earn favor with God. There had to be a greater sacrifice. There had to be someone who lived a perfect, sinless life who would come and take away the sins of the world. And they had this entire system built around dead works, these works that were basically useless. It's moralism, it's legalism in that sense, that to think that you could just change your behavior and by changing your behavior you earn favor with God. Can I tell you this? There is nothing you could ever do. There is no work under heaven that you could ever accomplish to obtain the righteousness of God. Amen. It's only through Jesus. It's only through the grace and mercy of a sovereign God that you and I would ever have any hope of eternity. We need to be reminded of that in this day and age that tells us that there are so many things that we aspire to that are attainable. Things like world peace or ending hunger in this world. I mean, you read about that in newspapers. You see that on TV commercials, and people are striving towards those things, to obtain those things in this day and age. For the Christian, we know those things are not attainable in and of our own strength. You leave man to his own devices, and we will fall into sin every single time. That's just the truth. And so if we're relying on our works, they are as dead as a doornail. And those works are useless. So a key element of the gospel message is to repent. To repent from dead works. Literally, to turn away from the things of this world, the useless works of the flesh, and turn towards the things of God. I just believe this. I mean, they can call me whatever they want to. They can call me dogmatic or bigoted or old-fashioned or whatever, but I still believe the gospel message involves repentance. Amen. You see somebody who professes Jesus with their mouth and yet lives like the world, you have to wonder whether or not they've truly encountered the Jesus that we know. You see somebody who is unrepentant in their ways, someone who speaks good things but doesn't live accordingly to the gospel message, and they are completely unrepentant when it comes to sin. Can I tell you this? If you are a Christian living in sin, if you are a true believer living in sin, that's the most miserable place to be in. The Holy Spirit will convict you day in and day out until you are drawn back into His presence. Doesn't make sense for a Christian, a believer in Jesus, to live an unrepentant lifestyle. So there's that, repentance from dead works. There's also this, the doctrine of baptisms is the way the King James, the New King James Version phrases it. I think this is really talking about ritual cleansings. It's not baptism in the sense that we usually remember baptism. They use the plural here, doctrine of baptisms. There were those in the several Jewish communities who practiced baptism as more of a ritual cleansing, and it symbolized maybe something a little different. It symbolized their desire to repent and their desire to turn away from the things of this world. We see those examples in ancient Jewish communities like the Qumran community, where they did practice ritualistic baptisms or washings and cleansings. As believers today, we're baptized, as we're told in the book of Ephesians. We have one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and our baptism today symbolizes our relationship with Jesus. So if you respond to Jesus in salvation, you are baptized by immersion. That's the biblical way. You're baptized by immersion underwater. You're brought back up, raised to walk in the newness of life, and that symbolizes your new walk with Jesus, and you're baptized once. It doesn't happen multiple times. You're baptized once because it is directly symbolic of your personal relationship with Jesus. And that's the model that we see in the New Testament. When people came to know Jesus and Him crucified, when they responded to the message of the gospel, they repented and they were baptized. It was symbolic of that one moment, that one instance where they trusted and they believed in Jesus. So, for us, of course, when we talk about the doctrine of baptism, the basic function of that symbolic act, it is representative of a personal relationship that we have with Jesus. Then the laying on of hands, another element of this foundation of faith that we believe in. What is that really talking about? Well, it could be talking about, in some sense, the ordination of church leaders. That's described in the New Testament where they lay on hands, and we continue, you know, that tradition even with ordination services today. But sometimes it was just to carry on the mission. It was, in a sense, a commissioning of God's people to go out and to do the work that God had called them to do. And the laying on of hands is symbolic of the continuation of the mission that God has called all of us to share the good news of Jesus. And He's been doing that for 2,000 years. He's been using billions of people that have come and have been a part of a local church body to carry on the mission that He has called them to do. The resurrection of the dead, another key element of the gospel story, is specifically the resurrection of Jesus. Listen, you don't have the gospel without the resurrection. We have hope, and we can trust in the name of Jesus because Jesus is resurrected in all glory and power. It's because Jesus is alive today that we have hope to live for tomorrow. And then also, we can't forget this, of eternal judgment. Maybe that's one element of the gospel that is easy to skip today, but it's a reality for those that do not believe in the name of Jesus. There is eternal judgment that awaits those. So all of these things are elements of the foundation of the gospel story, basic principles, basic doctrines, things that we should all believe in. And these are good things. Don't miss this. This is a good thing to go back to this foundation, to not forget this foundation, to not neglect this foundation. But then the writer of Hebrews urges those that he's writing to, and I believe it speaks directly to us today as well, we shouldn't stay there. There should be progression in the Christian life. These are basic doctrines, fundamental doctrines, but we should desire to go further in our relationship with Jesus, in our study of God's Word. We should desire to know Him more every single day. Don't stay just with the basic foundations. Continue on through the whole counsel of God. Listen, can I tell you this, Christian? We need this Word. This is our spiritual sustenance, and we need every word of it from Genesis to Revelation. And so we just believe in many aspects here at Second Baptist. We just believe in expositional preaching, that we would go through God's Word. Listen, if I'm not preaching God's Word, I don't need to preach. If there's not the proclamation of God's Word that's taking place in a church, then that person just needs to sit down. As Steve Lawson said, there are two kinds of pastors in this world, those who preach the word and those who need to resign. And I say amen to that. Listen, we need God's word from the very beginning to the very end. We need every single verse of it. And we need the whole counsel of God. So we can't just stay with the elementary principles, the basic doctrines. Listen, Charles Spurgeon said that God's Word deepens and widens with our years. As we study God's Word, we can never fully reach the bottom of it. We just continue to grow. We continue to saturate ourselves in the richness of God's Word, immerse ourselves in the goodness of God's Word. And it's a well that never runs dry. As believers, there should be a progression. There should be a pursuit of all the doctrines of God. The problem with many today is that we have, even within the church, put on this pedestal the idea of unity. We just all want to be together. We just all want to sing Kumbaya. And preacher, don't get too specific about doctrine because it's going to separate people. It's going to divide people. Well, you're right. Doctrine does divide people in certain ways. But when doctrine divides, it also solidifies. It also unifies the body of Christ closer together. And so the problem in many of our churches is that there has been a pursuit of unity. And really this pursuit has just been a pursuit of the lowest common denominator. Let's just talk about generalities as general as we possibly can so that nobody gets offended, so it caters to every single person in the audience. Let's just talk about the basic things, the more fundamental things, just so it touches on every single person and nobody disagrees with what's said behind the pulpit. Listen, if there is not a point in time where you get a little frustrated maybe with Scripture, or maybe you get a little frustrated with what the preacher says, if there's not a point in time where you say, "Preacher, you're stepping on my toes," then I'm not really doing my job. Because the Word of God challenges us. The Word of God molds us and shapes us into who we are. There are times we need to be convicted of this Word. And can I promise you this? I'm convicted of this Word during the week as I study it for myself. Long before I ever reach the pulpit to preach it. So the problem is that sometimes we focus just on the basic doctrines because we're pursuing this lowest common denominator, whatever it is that everybody can agree on. There will be those that accept the gospel and those that reject it. That's a reality that we see in this passage. That's the illustration that's used here in chapter 6 when it talks about the earth which drinks in the rain that often comes upon it. Sometimes it's going to bear herbs that's useful, and then other times it's going to bear thorns and briars, and it's rejected, whose end is to be burned. It's a clear illustration pointing to the fact that when the Word of God is shared, when the Word of God is proclaimed, there will be those who believe it and those who reject it. And maybe we're living in a day and age where we just want to be accepted by everybody. We just want everybody to say yes. We just want everybody to be happy. And Christian, you have to remember this. When truth is presented, there will always be those who accept it and those who reject it. There will always be those who turn against the ways of God, who say, "I want nothing to do with the truths of God's Word." And it's in those moments we don't cater to that. We don't change truth to make it more palatable for them. We stand firm in the truth of the gospel and we pray. We pray for their repentance. There is the idea here in verse 4. It may be a little confusing when we think about eternal security. We believe that we are once saved, always saved. That when we trust in Jesus, there's nothing that could ever separate us from the love of God, as Romans chapter 8 tells us. It may seem a little confusing when you read about verse 4. It's impossible for those who are once enlightened, have tasted the heavenly gift. It's impossible for them to renew them again in verse 6 to repentance. Wording may seem a little different. I would take the approach of Calvin, though, in this verse. John Calvin just believed that these are people who didn't fully have an experience with God. Maybe they had been presented with the gospel. They heard the truths of the gospel. They saw and they heard the gospel message, but they didn't fully believe. They experienced a presentation of it, but they didn't believe in it. And so it's talking about those who are unrepentant, those who don't trust in Jesus. But we can't forget our foundation, these basic doctrines of the faith. We go back to them often. But then, Christian, don't stay there. Pursue the Word of God in your lives. Secondly, the better things that are ahead, I think we remember this, that God will remember your labor of love as you pursue Him. And I love the way the King James Version, or the New King James Version, puts this. It is a labor of love. As you progress in the Christian life, God is faithful to remember your effort. God's faithful to count those things into consideration. It's a labor of love as we serve God and as we serve others. You know, sometimes loving people, it feels like a task that we labor in. I think that's a good way to put it. Love is not easy sometimes. Serving and ministering to other people, it's not easy. And so listen to me. I'm not talking about the romantic Disney princess and prince love story between a woman and a man, this idealistic picture of love that we have on our wedding days or whatever else that it may be. And sometimes I wonder if we are preparing our daughters for failure when we say this is what love is, when we give them the Disney princess story, when we give them the pretty little, you know, golden slipper story or whatever it is in Cinderella, and we give them this idea of what love is, what you should pursue, and this is what your Prince Charming looks like. Can I just go ahead and tell you this? Parents, you can get mad at me after the service if you want to, but there is no such thing as Prince Charming, all right? He's not there. He's not perfect. There will always be people who are flawed. There will always be people who just have issues and things that go on in their lives. And listen, your children aren't perfect either. That's just the reality. That's the truth of life. But we're not talking about this romantic type of idealistic love in this. We're talking about real love that is hard, that you labor for. The real hard work of loving others. Maybe we don't need to sugarcoat marriage for some of our young folks. Maybe we need to be upfront and honest with them. Marriage is not easy. When you grow up and when you find someone and you pray for that person and you marry that person, there will be problems that come up. You're going to disagree. There are going to be issues. It's not easy. It's going to be work for you to love your spouse, and it's going to be work for your spouse to love you. And all God's children said, amen. And amen. But listen, it's not just in the marriage relationship. It's in any relationship. It's with our parents. It's with our kids. It's with our grandkids. It's with those that are at work that we're supposed to serve. It's with our brothers and sisters in Christ. Listen, there are times when it's frustrating coming together and trying to love someone who doesn't care for you, doesn't love you back. But this labor of love is defined by your ministry, your service to the Lord and to other people. That's what ministry is. Everybody has a ministry. We're all called to be ministers in that sense. We're all called to be servants of God and servants of others. Ministry is service. But your service to the Lord and to other people, that reflects your walk with God. That reflects your progression in the Christian life. Now here's where we have to be careful. We live in a specialized society. And in this specialized society, we have specific jobs that we've been trained in to do. It's different than an agrarian society of 150 years ago, when everybody around here 150 years ago was a farmer. They had to figure out how to farm, but they also had to figure out how to manage the farm. They also had to figure out different elements of the farm. There were a lot of different skill sets that were involved in agrarian societies, and you had to know many different things and how to do those things. But in our society today, many of us, we may have a hobby of having a garden or whatever else, but we're not farming for sustenance, many of us. Instead, we have a specific job that we've been trained to do, whether it's to teach or whether it's to be an administrator or a librarian or a firefighter or anything else. We have a skill set, and we've been specifically trained to accomplish that job because we live in a specialized society. But I want us to be careful in taking that mindset and applying it to the kingdom of God. Because God's not asking for your skill. God's not asking for your intellect. He's not asking for all your talent, everything else that you have to offer to the kingdom of God. God is asking for your willingness. God's just praying for you to have your hands open. He's wanting you to have your hands open, willing to serve and to work and to minister to other people. Somebody said it this way. You've probably heard it said. God's not asking for your ability. He's asking for your availability. And I think that that's true. None of us are above serving other people. None of us, no matter how specialized or how skilled we may become at whatever job it is, because compared to the skill set of God, man, there is no comparison. We have nothing to bring to the table in comparison to what God brings to the table. We may think we're talented or skillful in a particular area, but listen, compared to the things of God, God is in control of all things. He's more powerful than anything we could ever imagine, any person we could ever imagine. Does God want to use our talents for his glory? Sure. Yeah, God does that in his own wonderful way. God can use your talent, but know this, he can accomplish his will without your talent. He can accomplish his will without your skill. He simply wants our labor of love. And we need to remember that in the kingdom of God and the service of God and to other people. I know a church where they have a pastoral internship, where there are people that go to be trained as pastors and they work as interns in this church. And the first thing that they do in this internship is they clean all the toilets in the children's wing of the building. I thought, man, what a great idea. Just to remind us and to humble us down from time to time, what we have to offer the kingdom of God is nothing in comparison to what God himself offers. And all of us are just servants of the Most High God. We went door to door yesterday in a motel. A few of us volunteered with Celebrate Recovery and motel here in town. And y'all know that there are people in very dire circumstances in our town, and many times we don't even see them. I was told yesterday by somebody who lived there of a group of about 30 people who just are camping in the woods. They're homeless, and I drive by there every day. Never saw them, but he said that that's where they live. And we went door to door inviting them to Celebrate Recovery and talking about Celebrate Recovery, especially this coming Thursday. We're just trying to, David and some other folks are getting together outreach night this Thursday. And so I'd invite your kids. There's childcare and everything else. And there's a ministry we're working with, New Creation Ministries out of Bremen. They're trying to get into the motels here in Cedartown to minister to their needs. And I was talking to one guy who had been living in this motel for 3 months, and we had a good gospel conversation about some different things, and we prayed with a few folks, and but he told us, he said, you know, he grew up in Atlanta, and he said the time that he's lived here in Cedartown, he's noticed that there are things here that are just as bad as Atlanta. He said, you go down, he told me what street, and he says, just like Fulton Industrial here in Cedartown. With the drug use, with everything else that's going on. And I remember, you know, we prayed for him and his situation and invited him to Celebrate Recovery. And can I tell you this, and I don't say this to pat anybody on the back, but going door to door and just telling people about Jesus, that requires no skill set. There's no talent that I offered that person. If I go door to door like that, I usually don't even say, you know, I'm pastor so-and-so or whatever. It doesn't matter. If I'm a pastor of a church, I'm just a Christian. I'm a believer in Jesus. Anybody can knock on a door and invite them to church and invite them to come to specifically Celebrate Recovery in this instance. Anybody can have a conversation with this guy. Anybody can pray with him. Some people don't need your skill set. They don't need all of your knowledge and everything that you know. They just need somebody to love them. Somebody just to share the gospel with them. Man, we think so often, we think, well, I'm in a better place. I'm growing in my relationship with the Lord. I'm doing pretty good. I've got things in order, got my ducks in the row. All these other folks, they don't. So I've got something that I can offer them. Can I tell you, listen, compared to Christ Jesus, there's nothing you have to offer them. All we have is Jesus. And that's all we need. That's all we need to offer them is just Jesus. Just point them to the gospel, the hope that we have in Christ Jesus. Just tell them about Jesus. Man, it'll change their lives. It'll change every aspect of their life. And God will remember that. God will remember that. Not our puffed up, idealistic picture of all of our skills and everything that we think that we have to offer. Listen, that's not our labor of love. Our labor of love is just serving other people. Just rolling up your sleeves and loving them as Jesus would love them. Pointing them to the hope that we have in the gospel. Just our willingness to go and to tell somebody about Jesus. God will remember that in the long run. Lastly, I want to point to this. When we think about the Christian walk and progressing in the Christian walk, we should note what actually shows spiritual maturity in the Christian walk. And what shows spiritual maturity is obedience. obedience to the will of God. You take somebody who professes Jesus with their mouth and yet denies him with their works. If they're a believer, then they're not spiritually mature in their walk with the Lord. If they don't take God's word and apply it to their lives, or attempt to apply it to their lives, we're going to falter at times. But if they don't take God's word seriously and apply it to their lives, then they're not spiritually mature in their walk with the Lord. I love the way the Christian Standard Bible phrases this verse here in verses 11 through 12. Now we desire each of you to demonstrate the same diligence for the full assurance of your hope until the end. Christian, we should be diligent in sharing the hope of the gospel so that you don't become lazy, but will be imitators of those who inherit the promises through faith and perseverance. Obedience to the will of God shows spiritual maturity. You give me somebody who's willing to work, willing to serve the Lord and to serve others, then that is, I believe, a sign of their growing relationship with Jesus. I wonder what Christians in persecuted countries think about churches in the U.S. sometimes. All of our resources, all of our stuff, all of our budgets, everything that we have, we've got it in abundance here with churches in the United States. And I wonder what some of those believers think, those that have absolutely nothing. They don't have a building, they don't have budgets, they don't have Sunday school material, they don't have any resources. Many of them don't even have Bibles that they can take home in persecuted countries. And I wonder what they think of us and our walk with the Lord. Not that we want to be pleasing to men, we want to be pleasing to God. But I wonder how believers, brothers and sisters in Christ in different circumstances around the world look at the church in America. Some have to worship in the dead of night to escape persecution, to not get caught. For some, they leave behind their family and their friends to pursue Jesus. They leave behind those that have raised them, those that have brought them up into this world, the only social networks that they know. They leave them behind to follow Jesus because they know that they've rejected the message of the gospel, those that are in their family and those that are their friends. They sacrifice so much in order to follow the things of God, in order to study His word and to apply His word directly to their lives. Many may even lose their jobs, their livelihood, everything that they have in order to follow Jesus. And then look at us. We're spoiled. Hello? Preacher, don't go there. I didn't want to hear this message. We're spoiled. We get a little bit of persecution and many Christians in this country start running the opposite direction. Get a little bit of social pressure. We've given God a couple hours a week and we think we're doing something special. We go to church one time rather than being at the lake and we think that we're sacrificing for the cause of Christ. There's a story after a matter of living in America for a few months, an Iranian couple. They came here and they lived here in America for a couple of months. They decided to move back to Iran. And why is that? This is what they said. The wife told her husband this. There's a satanic lullaby here. All the Christians are sleepy and I'm feeling sleepy. Man, God, break our hearts over that. Break our hearts over that. That we have every resource imaginable, everything possible that we would ever want in the church. We have it here in America, and yet we are apathetic in our walk with the Lord. And yet we sacrifice hardly nothing to come and to be a part of a worship service at Second Baptist in Cedartown. We all have Bibles on our shelves in every room in our house, and we never pick it up and we never read it. God forbid. God forgive us. God forgive us of our apathy in our walk with the Lord. God, forgive us of our sleepiness in pursuing God a satanic lullaby here. In the Christian church in the United States, we're all being sung to sleep by Satan himself in our apathy and our lack of spiritual maturity, our lack of obedience to the will of God. And the writer of Hebrews says this, I desire these things. I desire better things for you. Don't become sluggish, as the Christian Standard Bible says. Don't become lazy in your walk with the Lord. But imitate those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. There will be sacrifices in our walk with God. That's the nature of being a Christian. We've been called to die to self. Maybe we're looking for the wrong things in determining spiritual maturity in this day and age. We're looking at passion. We're looking for an experience. We're looking for an emotion to feel something. And that, we think, is a sign of spiritual maturity. Here's a sign of spiritual maturity. When you read God's word and you're transformed by it, and you desire it, and you want to grow more in it. When you read God's word and you do what it says, and you apply it to your lives, you obey the word of God. It's a sure sign of spiritual maturity. May it be true of us that we pursued God with all that we have, but that we would read his word and that we would be transformed by his word and we would apply it rightly to our lives. Jesus said this, if you love me, keep my commandments. If you love me, keep my commandments. That's not legalism. That's the gospel. Legalism is, I'm going to try to earn the love of God. I'm going to try to do these things in order for God to love me. God loves you. God cares for you. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And whoever would believe in him will never perish but have eternal life. You don't earn the love of God. He loves you. But because a good and gracious God above loves you, it is our reasonable service to live for him. It's our proper worship to live for him, to love him. If you love me, Jesus says, keep my commandments. Pray at Second Baptist we would be a people who reject the satanic lullaby of apathy in this day and age. And we would pursue being transformed by the word of God. I'm going to have a moment before we partake in the Lord's Supper, where you just have an opportunity to respond. I'm going to ask the worship team to come on up and begin playing. We're going to have an opportunity. You feel led to come and pray this morning. This is your time. You can come as we sing. Maybe you feel led to respond in a way where you want to reject the apathy that's all around us. Or you want to pray about God doing something in your life. Praying that God would give you direction about something in your life. This is your opportunity to come. Maybe you need to pray and ask forgiveness. I need to ask forgiveness daily from the Lord. You want to just give it all over to him. I don't know what you're facing. I don't know what you're going through. But the Bible tells us that we should examine ourselves, as Paul says. Look introspectively. See if there's anything hindering our relationship with the Lord before we partake in the Lord's Supper. So I'm going to pray, and then they're going to lead us in a word of singing. God, we love you. We thank you for your goodness. I pray, Lord, that you would guide our time together today. Pray, Lord, that if there's anything hindering our walk with you, that we would remove it, that we would repent of it. God, I pray that we would get ourselves right with you today. Lord, I pray that we would be mindful of your love towards us and that we would respond in obedience, that we would care deeply for the mission, the work that you've called us to do. And Lord, I pray that right now, wherever it is that we are spiritually, I pray, God, that we would obey you, that we would heed your spirit, that we would be a people who respond in obedience. Lord, we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand? If you feel led to come and pray, this is your opportunity. We'll sing a song, sing a hymn.
Change my heart, oh.
We're going to sing another verse. You feel led to come and you want to be a part of the church family here at Second Baptist, this is your opportunity to come. Or you just want to respond to whatever the Lord's doing in your life, we're going to sing one more verse. You feel led to come. This is your time. Altars are open as you pray. Would you come this morning?
Change my heart, oh God.
Seated. I'm going to ask our deacons to come forward this afternoon and remove the cloth from the top here. As we remember the sacrifice of Jesus today, we should be mindful of the weightiness of this and the fact that Jesus gave it all for us. We've been doing this on a monthly basis just to remind ourselves this 100th anniversary of what draws us together, what unites us from different walks of life and different circumstances. We've been raised differently in so many things, but yet we're all found at the cross. We're all equal at the feet of Jesus because we've been saved. If you're a believer, you've been saved by the goodness of God. And so this is what unites us, what brings us together. And I just want us to be mindful this morning as we remember all that Jesus has done for us. Anything that we do for Him is just our reasonable service. When we consider that Jesus gave everything for us, it only makes sense that we would give our all for Him. He gave up His life. He left His throne in heaven above, and He died and He suffered on the cross of Calvary for you and for me. And so when Jesus says to us that we should take up our cross and follow Him, any sacrifice that we offer to the Lord, it pales in comparison to what Jesus has done for us, but any sacrifice that we offer the Lord only makes sense in His kingdom and all that He's done for us. So I ask Billy, would you bless the bread as we celebrate the Lord's Supper.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, for being willing to come and give your body for our good, Lord. We just thank you that you remind us this day of what you did for us. Lord, help us go out and share your word, Lord. We thank you every day for Jesus and Christ.
Amen. Thank you. Bible tells us he was betrayed and took the bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." We also remember during this time that not only was his body broken for us, it was bruised for our iniquities, but he also shed his blood on the cross of Calvary for us. The Bible tells us without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. And so while it may not make sense to the outside world, they may misunderstand this and not know exactly what it means, but it's only through the shed blood of Jesus that we have the hope of eternal salvation. It's through his sacrifice that we can obtain the righteousness of God. This is what happened on the cross of Calvary. He took our sins and he bore it himself. All of our sins, past, present, future, every one of our sins. He took on our righteousness. He took on our sinfulness. He who was without sin became sin for us. And what we're able to do because of the blood of Christ is we're able to take on the righteousness of Jesus. That's grace. That is the unmerited favor of God. Nothing that we've ever done to earn it. It's only through the shed blood of Jesus on the cross of Calvary that gives us hope for eternity. So, Alex, would you pray and bless the distribution of the fruit of the vine?
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you shed your blood for us, Lord, that you died in our place, Lord, to give us life, to give us hope of eternal life, Lord. We thank you so much for that precious blood, Lord. Dear Lord, I pray for each person and each family here today, Lord, that the fact that you died for us, Lord, would be supreme in our lives, Lord, that it would affect every part of our life so much that we would tell everybody we know what a great, glorious, and wonderful God you are, how you came to this earth and you died in our place, and your blood was shed for us. We thank you, Lord. Thank you.
In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me."